In this demo, I want to talk about how you can change your model to be precise to the dimensions. The first thing I did here is I set up some dimensions. Now, if you don't know how to do this, what you would do is use points or use curves or lines to create these dimensions. So, for example, I can use a line and I can type in some dimensions. So I can say, I know that the full width of this clock should be 26.77. So I can say for the x, y, and z, I want it to be 0. So you can say 0, enter, or 0,00. So it goes straight to the origin, 0 for x, y, and z. And then you can have a second coordinate. So for this coordinate here, we can see that we are looking at the y-axis, and we're looking at this number. So the order is always x, y, z. So we can enter the x, which would be 0. For the y, we would say this number here, 26.77. And the last coordinate would be 0. So we don't need to press 0, we can just press enter. And we get this point. So that's how you would check your dimensions. You would use some construction lines, make sure your dimensions are correct. If you're unsure about the number and you also want to check the line or the points that you've set up in space, you can go under this menu here, Drafting, and here you have a bunch of dimensions. So you have linear dimension, this one goes both horizontally and vertically, and so you can click on the starting point, end point, and you can measure a line. Now, you don't have to measure lines, you can also measure points. So let's say for some reason we want to create a point instead of a line. So I will do that right now. Let's select that line. I selected one line too many, so let me deselect this. Okay, yeah, there's something going on here. Let's just do that. Let's go up here and use this button here, which will hide anything that is not selected. Okay, so now let's measure this line, go under Drafting, measure the length of this line, and here you have this dimension, 26.77. Let's delete this and let's create a point instead of a line. So you could go under Standard, click here on Single Point, and instead of saying 0, 0 and then the second coordinate, you can go straight to this coordinate up here. So this coordinate would be 0, 26.77, and for the z we can say 0 again, so we can just press enter, or if we really want to be precise, this doesn't change anything, but you can add a comma and 0. So we're saying x is 0, y is 26.77, z is 0. And now what it does is it creates this point. So you don't have to create a full line using coordinates at 0 to this point. You can simply enter a single point. So sometimes it is more efficient to create a point instead of an entire line. Plus you can create a line from a point. And you can also measure, let's do that, let's go under Drafting and measure the linear dimension from this origin. And note that I'm finding the origin by using the grid snap. So grid snap can be really useful, especially to find the origin, because the grid will always snap at the dead center on the 0, 0 of your xy, in this case xy, yeah, from the top view. So I hope this makes sense. So this is how you would check your construction drawings. If you see that there's just one dimension that's off and you want to get that dimension, you know, double checked or triple checked. So that's one way to do that. So at this point, we have a lot, but let's go here and show everything that we've created so far. And so this is a model that has essentially everything, but two of the curves are a little off. So let's go and check. So one of the problems that you'll see is you have all of these surfaces, and we can't really work both with surfaces and curves. So let's start getting organized. Let's go under the layers, create a new layer. And at this time I've selected everything and assigned everything to the default layer, and this is for the sake of a demo just to talk about how to get organized. But so what we can do here is we can divide our surfaces and our construction curves. So let's start with the construction curves. We can double click here and type in curves. So this is where we will put all of the construction curves, and here we will put all of the surfaces. Now for the surfaces, I'm not going to worry about any of the surfaces. I'm just going to focus on the curves. So let's start selecting either the curves or the surfaces. There's two ways to do that. One would be going under the selection menu up here, select, and under here you have so many options. So one of them is select curves. So this is one of the best options to select all of the curves at once. So we could do this, select all the curves and assign them to the curve layer. Let's do that right now. We can do a right click and we can change the selected object to this layer, change object layer. And now if I hide this layer, I can see the curves become invisible and then visible depending on this option. So this makes everything a little easier, especially for selecting surfaces. So now I can select all of the surfaces very quickly. Now if for some reason you have poly surfaces and surfaces, so some surfaces which are joined, some that are not, sometimes what you can do, let's see, yeah, here you have duplicates, so that's another thing I should talk about. But so sometimes what you can do to select only surfaces or only poly surfaces would be to click here, select surfaces. And so here it will select any surfaces and I can assign them to the surfaces layer. So let's do that, let's assign it by using the change object layer. Now another thing you could do is you could select your surfaces, go under properties, and you can also change the layer up here within the object properties. So let's use this menu just for the sake of a demo to show you how you can do that. So you can either use the object properties or within the layer menu, or I should say the layer panel, you can change object layer. So same option, two different ways to access this option. So now we have surfaces which can be hidden or visible or invisible, because we don't use the term hidden or show, because hidden or show refer to hide object, show object, this option here. So it is a little confusing because these hide object, show object options work independently from the layer visible, layer invisible options. So keep that in mind. If something is hidden and the layer is visible, you can't just click on invisible and visible to show an object. You have to click up here. So keep that in mind. The show and hide is completely independent from the layer visible, invisible options. So one last thing I haven't talked about is how the selection works and how we can really use it to get rid of surfaces, for example. So here we have 1, 2, 3 surfaces on top of each other. So these are duplicated surfaces that have been copied on top of each other. So an option here that we can use is this one. Here we have select exact duplicate objects and we have select all duplicate objects. So depending on whether we do a right click or a left click, we can use one option or the other. So if I use the left click and then press delete, now I'm left with a single surface. So there's two different options, right? I just did a Ctrl Z to go back to where I was previously. But so here, if I use a left click, it selects exact duplicates. And if I use a right click and press delete, it deletes every single thing. So here it selected every single surface, including all three surfaces in this case. But we want to select two of them and keep one of them. So these are two different options and it really depends on what you want to do. But if you select all duplicate objects, then you will have to hold Ctrl and deselect one of these surfaces, which can be very difficult. So now if I press delete, I should be left with... okay, I guess I selected the wrong option. So just try both options and figure out which one works. I believe I just made a mistake. Maybe I said the opposite. Let's see, if we do a left click and press delete, this time it worked. Okay, that's interesting. Let's try the opposite and do a right click and press delete, and it deletes everything. Okay, so you want to use the first option, which is the select exact duplicate objects, and this one will select all duplicates, but it will keep one copy of them, so you have no duplicate surfaces anymore. So let's go back to the topic at hand. We just took care of the surfaces. Now let's look at the curves, and let's make sure that the dimensions are correct. So from a top view, we can see that everything lines up correctly, all of our dimensions are correct, except up here. So how do we fix this? We can fix this by first deleting all of these curves, and we can create a point. So I should have kept the point instead of deleting everything over and over again. So one of the quickest way would be clicking on this option, single point. And here it is asking for a coordinate. And we know what the coordinate is. It is 0, 26.77, enter. And it just created a single point. So why is this important? That's because by using this point, I can get the arc by clicking simply on the edges. Right, but to do this, I need to make sure that this object is positioned in a way that makes sense. So there's a few strange things happening here. One of them is the center line is a little off, and so I've been messing with this construction curve a little. So I need to make sure it goes back to the dead center. So one way to do that would be using the move command under transform move, and of course there is the alias M. Enter, which I would recommend you use because it's a lot more efficient than clicking twice every single time you move an object. Using the keyboard is just faster. So let's go up here, make sure your object snaps are using the center point, and the endpoint is always useful. So these are good options. Let's go to the center and let's make sure that this is centered to the grid. Now if I don't want to use the grid, I can also just type in 0. Move point, it doesn't seem to let me do that. Okay, let's press 0 and see what happens. 0, enter, and it worked. Okay, so when you press 0, what it does is it moves the selected object from point A to point B, and point B is the coordinate I used, which is 0. Would be 0, 0, 0, which is x, 0, y, 0, z, 0. So that's referred to as the origin, so it's the center point of the world space. So it basically took the model from the center point of the circle and aligned it straight to the origin. So why is this useful? Because we need to dimension everything, and if we dimension everything from a center point, it makes the whole process a little easier. So it's just one way to be more efficient. Now you do not have to do that, but it might save you some time. So now we know that this point would be the center of this arc, which originally wasn't perfectly centered. So let's go up to the arc menu, click on this triangle at the bottom of the menu, and here you have a bunch of options. Now you can also access any of these options by going under curve, arc, and here you have a bunch of arc options. So let's go under one of these options. We have the start end point or start point end. So maybe for this arc it would make more sense to use the start point end. So let's click on one of the endpoints, the new point that we created, and the third point, which would be this other corner. And that's it, so that's all we need. We have an arc, and it goes to the correct point. It gives us the correct dimension. So that's how you would fix that. Now, to get the other side, you could mirror it and then use the split command. I'm not going to show that because it's a bit time consuming, and all I want to do at this time is focus on this. So this is a different type of issue. It relates to the point layout. So we don't want this point to be here, we want this point to be more up here, right? It needs to line up in a way that is consistent, because if you look at this arc, This point is linear, so this point here, at the middle of the arc, it has a relationship with the first point, which is straight. On the z-axis, it lines up perfectly. And this is an arc. So one way I can check if it's an arc is by going under the drafting and look at the radii or the diameter. So if I look at the radii, I can see whether it changes in size, and it does not because it is an arc. So an arc, just like a circle, will have a constant dimension. So we know that. We also know that this is just not the result that we are looking for. Now it could be an arc, I don't know, I can check. I can go up here and check. It says 58.54, and here it changes and goes to 55. So from 58 to 55, this is not an arc. So let's delete both of these curves, and let's check if we have some duplicate curves. So we do. We already know how to take care of that. We can go under the Select menu, or I should say the Select tab, and here we can click on Select all of the curves. Now another thing I haven't said, I haven't mentioned before, is all of these selection tools, they all start with SEL. So whenever you type SEL, you can select all of the curves. You can also do SEL, and then let's say we want to select joined surfaces, so we can type in poly, and we will have poly surfaces. And as you can see, it ends with SRF. So this means surfaces, which means if we just type SEL, SRF, now we can select surfaces. In this case, it doesn't make sense, we don't have any surfaces. But what I want to illustrate here is that using the commands can be quicker than using these panels. Sometimes you just want to stay here because you know you're going to use some of these tools. So maybe it's more efficient to type in the command. It's up to you, whichever method you think works better for you, you know, it doesn't matter. Whatever works best for you is the best method. Okay, so let's talk more about selecting duplicate curves. So we can go here and do SEL duplicate. And so here you have two options, cell dupe or cell dupe all. So we want to select duplicates, and we want to delete the duplicates. So that's why I was telling you SEL is really useful, right? Because I can select curves, I can select duplicate curves. Now of course, if you're trying to look for something that you don't know, like a chain, whatever that means, I've never even used it, it's not going to be easy to know what you're doing, right? If you try to select a random component that you've never used. So yeah, keep that in mind. SEL lets you select things, but the list of things you can select is very large. So I would just memorize CRV, which is for all the curves, and surfaces, SRF. And of course, you can go back in the video, you know, go back in time and look at what I'm doing if you're unclear about this. Yeah. So let's delete some of these extra curves, which are kind of getting in the way at this time. Let's delete this and that. And now let's focus on the corner transitional surface. Transitional curves, I mean. So at each of the corners, we have these arcs. So there's many ways to do these arcs. One of the ways would be to rotate the entire object. So we'll just do that now because it may be the quickest way to do this. You can select all of your curves and simply rotate the object. So you can type in rotate, or you can go under transform, rotate. And here we can rotate by 45 degrees. So let's type in 45, enter. And now the whole object is rotated at 45 degrees, which means this is now flat with our construction plane on the right view. So this may be a good way to do it because we can go under the arcs, and let's use this panel this time. And let's use this one, the direction. So here there's two options. Let's see, we have start and direction. So let's use the first one using a left click, start point, end point. And now we have to define the direction. So if I hold shift, that's it. It gives me the direction and it calculates the arc. And that point is linear with this point. So that's it. That's an easy way to create this arc. And now all we have to do is rotate the object back in place. Let's deselect some of these dimensions. Rotate. And we can rotate it by minus 45. So technically this is it. We would be done at this point. We can create an array for times, array polar. Or let's look at some other methods. Let's go on the other side and try something else. So this time we will use the front view. Let's use the same arc once again. And what is this one? This is a start. Yeah, let's use the same option again. So left click on this arc, which is called the start and direction at start. And let's click up here. And you can see in perspective, this point may not be where you want it to be. So you have to pay close attention. As you can see, it went to the backside. Right, so this may not be what we want. So you have to be really careful about where you're clicking. Now, if this is a problem, what you could do is create a line. Right, so you can go up here, click, hold shift. Now we just created a line. We know that this line intersects with our circle, because we clicked from the front view where they both intersected. And one thing I should say too is the way I just did that was by using the INT object snap. So you have to use this object snap to be able to do this. So if you use the intersection object snap, then it lets you find where these curves would intersect. So yeah, pay close attention to your object snap. They can make your life a lot easier. So now we know that this intersects. So we can trim this, all right? We can select that and we can say we want to trim anything that goes beyond the circle on the left side. And now we have a point exactly where we want it. And if we want to be even more precise, we can create literally a point, a single point, where the circle intersects with that line. It seems like it's not exactly where I want it to be, so I will use the M to move this point back where it should be. It should be right up here. And okay, I'm not sure why it did not trim correctly. I guess I could go in a different view, like the right view, and I could try to trim it again, and it should give me the result I'm looking for. So that's another way to do this. You don't have to move a point, you can delete it and create a new point. But so this would be one way to get that point perfectly where it needs to be, if this is an issue for some reason. And now we still have the same problem where it could technically snap to something that's behind this circle. So if that's the case, if that's the case for you, you may want to hide these objects, and then to get them back later on, you can go here and show objects. Okay. So let's go and do this. Let's use the arc again. I will use the start and direction at start. Click on the point that we just created, and here it seems to go to the center. So in some cases, what you would want to do here is disable the center object snap. And here you go, now we're snapping onto the point. You also don't want to use near, because if you use near, it will snap anywhere on that curve. So near is one of the worst object snaps in most cases, because it simply doesn't give us the precision that we would need. So here we created a point, it snaps straight to that point. So yeah, keep an eye on your object snap. It's really important. And here, click on the endpoint. And now we have to define the direction. So how do we define the direction in perspective? It's really difficult. Now from a right view, this is very easy. I can hold shift. And this kind of works, but not really, because if you look at the perspective view, it goes straight. And it gives me a strange result looking at the front view. It gives me an arc on this side. So this doesn't work either. Now if I click up here, it gives me the right orientation, but then in perspective, you will see that this arc is almost like a line, so it's not what we want. So here's how you would fix that. You can go here in perspective, and hold the control key on your keyboard. Hold control, click once, and now you will see your cursor will go up and down. So if you do the same thing on the front view, hold the control key, click once, and make sure you click on the corner. Now let's look at other views, and you can see in perspective now it goes up and down on the Y axis. So this is called the elevator mode, and what it does is it looks at the orientation that you're looking at. So in this case we used the front view on the X and Z axis. We enabled the elevator mode by holding the control key. We clicked, then we let go of control, and now the point is going up and down on the one axis that is not available in this view. So here we're using a construction plane, which is X and Z, and now we're going in a normal orientation to the X and Z, which is the Y. So yeah, this works in every single view. It's a little complicated to understand, but just practice using it. Go under the front view, hold control, click once, and then you will see you can go up and down. So why is this nice? Because now the last reference point that we are using, which gives us the direction, can be aligned in a way that is perfectly straight. Because in the right view, if I hold shift, it actually doesn't work. That's interesting. I guess my object snaps are kind of not doing what they're supposed to do. But so, as you can see, it goes right and left. So all I have to do is go back to the endpoint or center point or midpoint, any of these points up here on the Z axis, on this green axis that you can see, and it will make it the correct distance. Now, if you're really picky about it, there's other ways you could do this. For example, you could select this point. You can move the point from its location to the green axis, and now you have a point in 3D, and it's at the correct position in 3D space. So that's another way to force the direction to go to the right point. So let's try that really quickly. I will click on the same exact option, start and direction at start. Click here, start point up here, end point up here, and then for the direction, I can click on this reference point I just created. Now this seems really easy, but using the elevator mode, if you understand how elevator mode works, is actually even quicker. So let's try that really quickly. Let's delete this point. Let's pretend we did not do that extra work. Left click, start point, end point. Go to the front view, hold control, click. Go to the right view, click, and we're done. So this is how you would fix the curve for the front side and the back side if you ran into issues. And we also looked at some other tools, so hopefully this will help you to correct any discrepancies between the dimensions that you're supposed to have as part of your construction curves. Yeah, so I hope this is helpful and that you will be able to make the necessary corrections.